Namaskar everyone. I hope everyone can hear me. And is it okay now?
Yes.
Thank you. So thank you Mahindra, thank you teamwork, thank you Sanjay for making it possible. And I am really very happy to be here and talking to you about Kabir. My book was mentioned, Akat Kahani Prem Ki. It was released in 2009, and at its release function, my supervisor, the legendary scholar of Hindi literature, Professor Namwar Singh, had quipped that Purushottam has taken only 32 years in writing this book, which is true. I started working on Kabir in 1977, and it was only after 3 decades or so that I felt little confident to talk about him in public and to publish my book. Kabir is unique, as we all know, but we tend to forget often that he is not alone. He is one of many like him. Those days, the 15th, 16th century, which to some people was medieval period of India, dark ages of India, this society had many like Kabir. We had Tukaram in Marathi, we had Narsi Mehta in Gujarati, we had Kanak Das in Kannada, and so on and so forth. We of course had Guru Nanak in Punjab, a very almost contemporary of Kabir. So, talking about Kabir just cannot be talking about an individual. It is also talking about his times and our times. It is also talking about his concerns and our concerns. And we talk about Kabir in this way. We must also be very clear about one thing, that essentially and primarily Kabir is a poet. Some people find it below his dignity to describe him as a poet. To them he is a guru, to them he is a religious reformer, social reformer and whatever. But Kabir is a poet. He does not bother about being recognized as one. But the way he uses his language, he is a poet. And as a poet, Kabir is not merely a poet of love and consolation, he is also a poet of anger and interrogation. Reading Kabir is not always a very pleasing experience. It can be a very irritating experience also, if you read him properly. And it can be so irritating, it can be so interrogating, that sometimes I feel that if he were alive today, he would be either in a asylum or in a jail. If not, already executed. And he would most certainly be called anti-national. That is for sure. So Kabir is not merely a poet of pleasing things. He is also a poet of disturbing questions. He is also a poet of interrogation. He tells about himself. As I told you, he does not bother to call himself a poet, but he says something about himself which gives the clue of his own understanding of his work. And he says, Main rovu ya jagat ko, moku rove na koe, moku rove so jana, jo sabad viveki. I lament for this world, but who will lament for me? Only those who have an understanding of the world, who have a vivek of sabad. And sabad, as we know, is the ultimate mystic name, ultimate mystic reality, but it is also the very real secular reality. It is only through language that you understand the world. It is only through language that you reconstruct the experience. So if you know how to understand the world, if you know how to reconstruct the experience, then probably you would lament for me, that is Kabir. Moku rove so jana jo sabad viveki. And why is that? Why is that so? Why he says that only those who have a vivek of sab, only those who understand the world will lament for me? Because he tells us that understanding yourself, talking of spiritual bliss, talking of spiritual quest, cannot be dissociated from the reality all around. You cannot be talking of pleasure ignoring the injustice. You cannot be talking of spiritual fulfillment ignoring the harsh social realities around. Realities of hatred, realities of aggression, and most importantly, realities of irrationality. To quote him again, भीतर कहूँ तो जग में लाजे, बाहर कहूँ तो झूठा लो, मैं कई विधि कथों गंभीरा। भीतर बाहर सबद निरंतर, मैं यही विधि कथों गंभीरा। If I say that he or it exists outside, it is not true because I feel this within me. But if I say that it exists inside, then also it is not true, because it permeates the entire existence. So outside and inside cannot be divided neatly. There is no binary. And what brings out this interrelationship is sabad, the constant word. Bhitar bahar sabad nirantar ehi vidhi kaho gambhira. The profound truth can be realized only in constant interaction of inside and outside. It cannot be that you don't bother about the world and be happy inside. And it also cannot be that you just bother about the world and don't bother about what's happening inside. Unfortunately, over last some period of time, maybe couple of centuries, many people have started believing in a kind of binary between rational and spiritual. You can either be rational or be spiritual. Kabir, and again, let me remind it again, not only he, many like him, in fact dozens like him, in Indian tradition, starting from 14th, 15th century, in almost all the vernacular languages, underline the fact that this binary is actually a misconception. There is no binary between rational and spiritual. There is no binary between outside and inside. And you cannot perceive the world in these binaries. If we look around, can we imagine any evolution of human mind without rejecting this kind of binary? I mean, we are living in 21st century and we have achieved great heights of technology, we have achieved great heights of scientific development, and at the same time we are also facing a kind of spiritual emptiness. This is something which no serious rationalist can ignore or achieve. And incidentally, again, at least in this Indian tradition, being spiritual does not necessarily mean believing in a particular conception of God. As a matter of fact, in Indian tradition, the word Nastik does not mean atheist. The word Nastik means one who does not accept the authority of Vedas. So you can be Astik even if you do not believe in it. You can be spiritual even if you do not believe in God. Kabir certainly did believe in God. Kabir certainly longed for God. But I am making a more general point, that in order to be spiritual, even believing in some kind of God is not exactly a prerequisite. It is not a precondition. That is the point which Kabir's poetry gives us insight. Kabir underlines in his work and also in words the importance of experience and putting it in a right perspective, asking correct questions. If you do not ask questions, you do not proceed. The whole human history is about asking questions, about experiencing, about experimenting, and putting your experience in some kind of theoretical perspective, in having some kind of theoretical perspective. Bhakti for Kabir, we all know he was a Bhakti poet. And again, this is extremely important to recall and remember. Bhakti does not merely mean devotion. Bhakti means insistence on participation. Bhakti is not merely I devote myself to you. Bhakti is an insistence on participation. Bhakti is an insistence on equality. The relationship of a bhakt in Indian tradition with his or her God is not of complete surrender. It's not a, I mean it is surrender, but it is not the surrender of a defeated soldier in a war. It is the surrender of a lover in love. I surrender to my beloved, I surrender to my lover, but that is not the kind of surrender an army surrenders to the victorious army. This is participation, equality. Read any bhakti poetry, Mirabai, Surdas, even Tulsidas. There is a constant emphasis on equality with the Lord, with the Deity. And so far Kabir is concerned, I mean, as you know, because of many of his utterances, many people have believed that Kabir was quite arrogant, and maybe he was. After all, someone who has the courage to speak through the power has some right to arrogance. I don't mind Kabir's arrogance, because he speaks truth to the power, which is important. So well, Kabir could go to the extent of saying, Kabir man nirmal bhaya, jaise ganga neer, piche laga hari phire, kahet Kabir kar. I have made my mind as pure as Ganga water, and therefore now I do not follow after, but Lord follows after me, and he chants Kabir Kabir. I do not chant anymore Ram Ram or Hari Hari. He chants Kabir Kabir, because my mind has become as pure as Ganga water. And mind you, Ganga not of today, Ganga of 16th century. So when we are talking of the purity of Ganga water, it is not this Ganga water which none of us is going to touch. Pretty sure. So this purity, this insistence on purity and interrogation, and also a great sense of irony and humor. Like any great poet, Kabir is not a dry person. If you read his poetry of love, if you read his expression of love, longing and pain, it brings tears to your eyes. And it is so erotic. In his poetic moments, Kabir is so erotic. Bala aao hamare gehre, तुम बिन दुखिया देह रे, सब कोई कहे तुम्हारी नारी, मोको कछु संदेह रे, एक में एक है सेज ना सोवे, तब लग कैसा ने. Oh my dear, oh my beloved, come to me. I am longing for you. Everybody says that I am your woman, I am your wife, but I doubt it because we have never shared the bed. And unless we share the bed, what is the point of loving each other? So Kabir's love is not of the 19th century European romantic variety. It's a very rooted love, very secular love. He wants milan. He wants consummation of that. So, as a poet, and on the other hand, Being a bit imprudent, I don't know how many of you have actually read Kabir. Because these days, I believe we are passing through the age of a kind of neo-illiteracy. We hardly read anything. We are too much into listening and hearing to good and bad things, to sensible things and to nonsense, but hardly into reading anything. Reading has become almost a kind of specialized activity reserved for us, or we people, the so-called professors and the scholars, are condemned to be reading. Everybody else is just contented with the ghost trap and all those gadgets which we always carry in our pocket. But if you read Kabir, there is a particular kind of poetry which he is known very much for, and it is called ulat bansi, upside down language. It has been interpreted in many mystic ways, because in that many impossible things happen. Fish climb the tree, water gets fire, many strange and impossible things happen. The sun and moon come to the earth, everything gets topsy-turvy, and therefore it is called ulat bansi, upside down language. And there has been a tradition of that ulat bansi which Kabir got from the heritage. There were many people before him who were composing poems in that idiom, and therefore lot of mystic element has been read into these ulat bansi. And no problem with that, after all great poets can be read in many ways. But if you read those ulat bansi without knowing a single thing about mysticism, or without knowing anything of the technical meanings of various terms in ulat bansi, just read it and you would find it amazing, amusing and disturbing. For example, in one of his poems, a situation is described that a marriage is going to take place and everybody is getting ready. So it's a description of a wedding feast in which the houseflies are getting a hairdo because they want to attend the marriage feast. Maki mool maravan lagi hamau ja parata. The lion is preparing the glory ja paan, better leaf. The rodent is serving. The poor mice is looking at everything and can't do anything except singing some songs of happiness. Udri vapuri mangal gaave. Now look at around ourselves. Isn't it true? Just look at newspapers. Just watch the television news this evening. And you would find many houseflies getting here. In the same poem, Kabir tells us that buffaloes are dancing. You will find many buffaloes performing Bharatanatyam on television and in the newspaper. You need not read any mystical meanings in all this. The absurdity. In last 20-30 years, particularly with the rise of so-called postmodernism, all kind of absurdities have got unprecedented respect. Only recently there was a holy man in southern parts of this country who claimed among stage followers that I told son to rise 40 minutes later than the schedule, and it followed. And people clapped. People expressed happiness at this claim. And this man was not talking in the language of metaphor. He was not talking in the language of exaggeration, poetic exaggeration. He, according to him, was speaking the language of plain fact. He was giving the fact as if it's a newspaper report that maine Surat se kaha ke 40 minute der se utna aur bol gaya. I have no problem with that man, because such men have been around all the time. But his followers include highly educated men. You cannot be a follower of him if you are not educated, because the holy man only speaks English. In India, English is one of the most significant indicators of being educated, certainly not of being intelligent necessarily. But it is certainly one of the most significant indicators of being educated. So these are educated people, trained in science, technology, management, and they are clever. I mentioned this incident in a slightly irritated way in one of my classroom lectures, and one of the students got her sentiments hurt. These days, you know, we are having very delicate sentiments. And like every public talk I give, this is the time to tell you in advance, to apologize to you that I might have hurt your sentiments, or I might end up hurting your sentiments, and I would be very happy about that. But still, please forgive me if I hurt your sentiments. Because I'm not here to please your sentiments. I'm here to challenge. I'm here to force you to question yourself, to think about your sentiments, whatever they are. So this girl got very upset and told me, sir, it's a matter of faith for me. I have great faith in Swamiji and you should not be talking like that. I got slightly, you know, kind of afraid because this is a very fancy American type of university and the professors are supposed to be very careful of the sentiments of the students. So I really got afraid that this girl might end up complaining against me to the dean of students that he has hurt my sentiment, and what is that phrase? He has triggered a trauma. So I was very afraid of triggering her trauma. But I told her very politely that, look here, my dear, 40 minutes, sun did not rise. Do you realize the implications? Rising of sun or setting of sun, as we all know in this 21st century, is merely a metaphor of language. Sun does not rise, sun does not set. It is the movement of solar bodies, it is the movement of celestial body, the movement of solar system, because of which in India we find that sun is rising, in Europe they find that sun is setting. So are you trying to tell me that your Swamiji stopped the movement of celestial bodies for 40 minutes? Are you trying to tell me this? That Earth stopped, Jupiter stopped, Moon stopped, Saturn stopped, only then it was possible that sun did not rise for 40 minutes. And I told her that if this were to happen, for the tiniest fraction of a second, for a nanosecond, I and you would not be surviving discussing all this. This will be Mahapralaya. So you are saying that your Swamiji actually caused a Mahapralaya without causing any problem anyway. So this girl was taken away. So she told me that, sir, it's a matter of faith. And I'm very sorry, I have no sympathy with the faith which refuses to be scrutinized. I have no sympathy with any such. And I told her then bluntly that 200 years ago, this was the matter of faith for some people to burn the widows alive. And there were people who refused to sympathize with that faith. That is why you are alive and you are sitting in the class talking to your professor. Otherwise, at the age of 25 or 26, you would be mother of 4 or 6 children, or maybe burning on the pyre of your late husband. So let us not give too much of this, too much space to this faith nonsense. To put it very plainly, I'm sorry, please, but I'm not denying the importance of faith in life. But I'm saying that yes, faith is a matter of heart, but God. The same God who has given us heart and faith has also given us head. And it must be something in the divine scheme that he put our head 6 inches over and above our head. Must be some design in the divine scheme. So when we talk of faith, we must use our head also. We must use our rationality also. And that is what Kabir is all about. And reading Kabir, I really, really request you, please read it. Listening to his songs is wonderful, undoubtedly. But listening is a different kind of experience. Listening indeed is a kind of aesthetic and spiritual experience. And Kabir gives you a lot of that. But Kabir also gives you a lot of thinking experience, reflective experience. And that you earn only when you read. And good English translations are available. Linda Hesse's translation is super. Those who want to read him in English, please read Linda Hesse and Sukhdev Singh's translation. In Hindi, of course, there are many collections available and many, many people have published his collections and you can read, and in other languages also. The point is that when we talk of Kabir and people like him, I mean, this is a question which we constantly ask, and we naturally go back to history with this question, that what is the relevance? Why at all we should bother about it? I mean, he was a poet, good poet or bad poet, writing 500 years ago in this city. But why we should bother about it? Why we should be organizing such a wonderful festival celebrating Kabir? Because Kabir celebrates the totality of humanity. His poetry directly and implicitly rejects the binaries of every kind. Binaries of rationality and spirituality, binaries of social divisions, binaries of real and unreal. When he says that, I mean, this is a most moving poem and most, one could say, typical of the mystic experience which he talks of. Had had chale manva, behad chale saad, had behad dohu taje, takar mata agad. Ordinary people remain in boundaries. Sadhus cross the boundaries, but there are some whose wisdom is unfathomable, who actually go beyond the very idea of boundary and non-boundary. There is a stage of consciousness where this idea of had and behad itself becomes irrelevant. The most important thing about Kabir is that he tells you, and that is the assurance for someone like me, he tells you that for having that experience, you do not need a qualification given at birth. You need not be a Brahmin to have that experience. You need not be a Swet to have that experience. Kabir himself was, as we know, weaver. And he was proud of it. He constantly teached people, underlining his weaver identity. And sometimes he put that identity in a most moving perspective. Kabir's biography is also very interesting, whatever little we can construct of it out of legends. But it's a most interesting biography. And most educative also. In one of the incidents, it is said that some people try to lure him. Some people try to honey trap him, as the expression goes these days. So they send two beautiful, extremely beautiful women to him to honey trap Kabir. And Kabir tells them, "Aye hamare kaha karogi hum to jaat kameena, tahan jao jahan paat katambar agar chandan ghasleena." My dear lady, what will you do with me? I belong to Kameen. Now look at this irony. He is describing himself as Kameen because others considered his caste as Kameen. Aye hamare kaha karogi hum to jaat kameena, tahan jao jahan paat katambar agar chandan ghasleena. Go to that world, go to that part of world, go to that part of society where there is everything, where you would be required, where you would enjoy. What will you do with me? And if still at, this is a very long poem, and I wish I could read and translate the whole thing, but we do not have time for that. But at the end of the poem ends in a way which, at least to my eyes, it brings tears. It brings tears to my eyes. At the end of the poem, Kabir tells him, these two women, that if you really want to still insist, live with me, if you really want to honey trap me, if you want to live with me, then you are most welcome. Join me as my mother and my mausi, younger sister of mine, and join me in wandering in from jungle to jungle. Ek ma, ek mausi. Join me as a mother and join me in my wandering in jungle to jungle, because hum to jaat kameena. I do not have all those things which are required, and I'm not interested. It does not mean, however, and it's very important, because a misconception has been created about Indian tradition, about the Indian spiritual practices over the last 200 years. Because of the European and British misreading of Indian history and Indian philosophy, a misconception has been created that Indian tradition, particularly Hindu religion, has been otherworldly. Because they talk too much of moksha, they talk too much of liberation. Every Hindu talks of Maya, every Hindu is a born philosopher. Even a rickshaw wala in Banaras will tell you some Maya. So people think that every Hindu is Mayavadi. Every Hindu is kind of Shankaracharya making. This notion has been created in last 200 years. If you look at not only philosophy but history of India, and you just remember that the idea of moksha is not a standalone idea. It comes in a package, and package consists of three other things besides moksha. It is about dharma, artha, kaam, and then moksha. So earn your living, make money, be wealthy by righteous means, by correct conduct, and fulfill your desires. Fulfill your sexual and other desires. And then only talk of moksha. Moksha does not mean wo, ye main Hindi mein hi keh sakta hu, angrezi mein jo samjha sake wo samjha de, pass karte ho. Moksha does not mean ke nange nawab ke liye paida. Matlab only those who have something can abandon something. You remember Siddhartha as Gautam Buddha because he had a kingdom to abandon. You remember Ram as Maryada Purushottam because he had a kingdom to abandon and go into a kind of self-imposed exile for 40 years. And as Nehru remarked in his fascinating book, Kabira of India, that in fact this is a people, the Indian people, who always find some excuse of singing and dancing. And I can at least, I mean, I think this is true of all over India, except the westernized, modernized people like us, who do not like to express our emotions openly and publicly, we restrain ourselves. But if you look at ordinary Indian people, the fact is that hamara to siyapa bhi surila ho. When we lament for our dead, we lament in some kind of rhythm. Recall a woman in your neighborhood, way back in childhood, who was not English educated and was lamenting for something, or even fighting her husband. Even in the abuses, there is poetry. And I'm not joking. I'm very serious. At least in Hindi, to be properly abusive, you have to be highly creative. Otherwise, your abuses will be very boring and stupid. So this is a society, this is a tradition, which actually privileges exploration and creativity of heads, which actually privileges anand of every kind. No anand is base enough to be ignored. A society which is otherworldly does not revolve the idea of 56 bhogas, 56 bhog. आजकल 56 इंच का जमाना है, बट ट्रेडिशनली यू नो 56 भोग सैंपल ऑफ विच यू आर हैविंग हियर इन द लंच एंड डिनर. अ सोसाइटी विच इज नॉट बॉदर अबाउट अदर दिस वर्ल्ड विल नॉट इन्वेंट अ डिलीशियस मिठाई लाइक लवंग लता. दे विल डू विद एनी काइंड ऑफ सुगर और एनी काइंड ऑफ जगर. सो दिस इज नथिंग बट नॉनसेंस टू से दैट इंडियंस और पर्टिकुलरली हिंदूज आर अदर वर्ल्ड. दे आर नॉट. And therefore, even people like Kabir, when they talk of spiritual achievements, they do not reject the secular needs. And I am talking of secular in a philosophical sense, not in a political sense. In that sense, Kabir was not at all secular. I will come to that. Kabir is not talking of rejecting the this worldly need of human being. He is only talking of a sense of fair play, a sense of justice, a sense of participation. And again, this is ingrained in this particular philosophy in which Kabir was situated. The most favorite mantra from Isha Upanishad, which was Mahatma Gandhi's most favorite, and Gandhi described him as Gandhi described that mantra as the fundamental moral touchstone of everything. And the mantra is Isha Vasyam Idam Sarvam, यत किंच जगत्याम जगत तेन त्यक्तेन पुंजी था मागृत कस्य स्वित फल. The whole existence permeated by God or divinity or whatever you call it, and you have a sphere in this. Enjoy that. But never forget that others also have a sphere. You are not the only one to have a sphere. And when you forget that others also have the sphere in the bounty and Dorothy of God, then you end up being a Hitler. Are you being a, you end up being a billionaire in USA? So the idea is to enjoy, but with a sense of justice, with a sense of fair. I just mentioned that Kabir was not secular in the sense in which the word is used today. You know, in India today, secularism means being tolerant of all kind of religious nonsense. Particularly, if I am a Hindu, I should keep quiet about the practices in Islam. And if I am a Muslim, I should absolutely keep quiet about the practices in Hinduism, howsoever irrational or unacceptable those practices be. So that is not the idea of secularism. He is not the apostle of Hindu-Muslim unity as we understand it today. He is not bothered about various religious identities and their so-called sacred and tender sentiments. In fact, he is equally aggressive and equally blunt about whatever he perceives as irrational. The typical expression of this thing is one particular poem which takes care of both the dominant religious systems and the prides associated with them. And the poem is almost obscene. The poem is almost obscene. Jo tu bahman bahamni jaya, an baat kahe ni aaya. If you are a Brahmin and consider yourself purer than me or purer than others, then please tell me, why didn't you choose a more clean way of coming to this world? You have come to this world in the same quote-unquote dirty way I have come. So on what basis you claim to be purer just because of you are born a Brahmin? So jo tu bahman bahamni jaya, an baat kahe ni aaya. In the same line, in the next line, जो तू तुरक तुरक नहीं जाया भीतर खतना काहे न करा. So if you are a Muslim and proud of being a Muslim, then why didn't you have your circumcision done inside? I am sure if Kabir was not born 500 years ago, and if this was my original poem, if I had composed it, Sanjay would be putting his hand on his head. And would be worried about exporting me from Banaras as soon as possible. But I can get away with it because it is from Kabir. I can always tell the people who come teaching a lesson to me that please go and meet Kabir. He's not very far away. Go and teach him the lesson. I'm not the. So the point I'm trying to make in nutshell, I mean, one can go on talking about Kabir for hours and hours together. But the point I'm trying to make in nutshell is this, that Kabir is an experience in himself only if we remember a couple of things. One, he is unique, not alone. In this world, we also suffer from a celebrity culture, you know. After all, there can be only one Amitabh Bachchan, or there can be only one whosoever, Shah Rukh Khan or Deepika Padukone. Fortunately, in bhakti poetry, there are many Amitabh Bachchans. It's a different matter that we are talking only of God. So Kabir is unique, certainly. He is celebrated all over the place, and he is celebrated in fascinating ways. I mean, in Telugu country, in Telangana region of this country, we have Bhagat Ramdas, 200 years after Kabir, who is a Sagun Bhakt, unlike Kabir, who believes in the idea of incarnation, who is an idol worshipper, and he says that actually Kabir has given me the Tarak Mantra in a dream, and he was born 200 years after Kabir. And the Tarak Mantra is of course Ram. So Kabir has given me the Mantra Ram, He forgot about his previous name, he started calling him Ramdas, and now today he is one of the most revered and celebrated bhakti poet in Telugu language. Tukaram celebrates Kabir. Shankar Dev in Assam celebrates Kabir. Pipa in Rajasthan celebrates Kabir. So Kabir is an extremely celebrated poet, and for God's sake, this is also a misconception which is prevalent more in academics, that Kabir was discovered by English-speaking elite of this country. Sorry, that is not true. Kabir was never lost, so there is no question of discovery. I mean, you lost him because you stopped reading vernacular language, or you started reading vernacular only through English. That's your problem, not his. So anyway, so first thing is that Kabir is unique, but not stand alone. The other thing is that Kabir is not just about love and longing and lamentation. It is about love, certainly. Most certainly about love. But it is also about questioning, interrogating, and therefore it is also about rationalizing or asking rational questions about everything which is claimed to be spiritual. Kabir does not give this license to anybody that I am beyond questioning because I am claiming to be spiritual. No. You have to answer questions to Kabir. And that is, to my mind, and as I told you, I started off by saying that Kabir is essentially a poet. And how he perceives love, I mean, love can be seen in many ways. I like this dialogue from this not so good film, but this film. I like that much about our use of language. You remember that film, PK? There is an alien who gets surprised that these are funny people. They say something about something that they love it, and then they eat it. Because I love chicken and I eat chicken. I love puri and I eat puri. I love mithai and I eat mithai. So this alien from some other world is quite surprised at the use of language in this world. So love can be used that way also, and love can be used this way also, in which Kabir uses the idea of love. And this is the last. Can you give me just 1 minute? So Kabir says, Pinjar Prem Prakasya Antar Bhaya Ujas Mukh Kasturi Mehmahi Bani Puti Vas. How come I started doing poetry? I am not educated, I am a Julaha. What happened that I have become a poet? Pinjar Prem Prakasya. I felt, I experienced love throughout my existence, and my inner being was enlightened. And therefore, my voice, my words became as fragrant as the musk. And it is this fragrance of musk which we are still learning from, which gives us a food for thought, which gives us a lot to think about, lot to reflect about, and of course, not to question. Thank you very much.